meeting. I got distracted by an invitation to a port in South Korea, Keelung Port, and I'm not going, but it sounds interesting.
That's a sister port.
Yeah, sister port. Did we know we had a sister port? I'm not sure I knew we had a sister port.
Could
we
be
did?
A could be a brother port.
Could be a brother port. Today is the Tuesday, May 17th meeting of the Port of Bellingham. I'll let the record show that all three commissioners are present. And let's see, some advisory committee meeting schedules. Tuesday, May 12th, our airport advisory committee is meeting at 5 p.m. at the GA Conference Center at BLI. The TAC, the Technical Airport Advisory Committee, has a meeting scheduled, which is kind of rare. That's Tuesday, May 12th and July 14th, 9:30 a.m. at the GA Conference Room at BLI. If anybody's interested, they get kind of technical about airport stuff. And then Marina Advisory Group Committee is Tuesday, September 13th, 6 p.m. at the Harbor Center Conference Room, which is, I think, is that where we are? That's where we are. Did that go by already?
No, no.
September 13th. Yeah, and I believe it's in this room. All right, so we do have a public comment period. Is there anybody that would like to speak?
No one has signed up.
Nobody? At all? Wow. And there's so many people here today. I'm glad we're televising so that nobody does have to come anymore. I appreciate that. Yeah. Okay. Let's do a consent agenda. Consent agenda. Diane.
A motion to approve consent agenda items A through I.
All right. Any discussion about any particular item, gentlemen? No, sir. Mr. Briscoe? I said today was going to go quickly, and it's starting off great. You're good. Okay. It's getting better. All right. All in favor, say aye.
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 Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Briscoe. All right, let's head on right into our action items. We're going to start with a little Burger ABAM action here. Van, please.
Authorize the executive director to execute a professional services agreement with Burger ABAM to provide consulting services for the 2016 condition surveys in the amount of $50,800 plus a 10% contingency for a total authorized amount of $56,000.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Adam Fulton, Director of Facilities. Hello. This is pretty routine work for us. We follow, as you might read in your memo, we follow the American Society of Civil Engineers Manual of Practices number 130, which recommends how often marine structures should be surveyed for their condition. The surveys, the advice from the ASCE varies depending on the age of the structure and the type of structure it is. So wood pile piers require more often inspection than a steel pile or concrete pile pier. We more or less take an average of those and just say every 5 years, instead of 4 to 6 years, and we try to mess around. We're just saying every 5 years we take a look at our piers. We're in a process of marrying up infrastructure needs with tenant drive, with available budget to sort of look into how we can kind of standardize that and get ourselves into a five-year recurring cycle. And so it will take kind of a couple years of grabbing various geography to get them into that system. So with this one, we're doing two condition surveys, one here in Fairhaven. And we're basically going to look at everything. I'll use this. We're going to look at everything. Oh, thank you. All right. We're going to look at everything in that red box here in Fairhaven. And basically, we have divers and people that look at the coatings, and they take a look at all our piles and superstructure on those and recommend you know, any maintenance.
Hey, Adam, where's the bulkhead under the cruise terminal?
Yeah. I
don't
think you can get a different color for you, Commissioner. Bulkhead is right here where the concrete pier stops.
All the way? Whoa, really?
Yeah.
So that curved portion of parking is over water?
That's correct.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought it was right there on the edge. Wow.
And the second structure that we're looking at in this year's condition survey is the Squalicum Harbor Sawtooth. Not a surprise to anyone. And that's shown here. So this is the recommendation that we proceed with these condition surveys. We're spending about $50,000, I think, of an available budget, around $100,000, $120,000. And it is the staff's recommendation to proceed. Do the commissioners have any questions?
Mr. Briscoe?
No.
Mr. Robbins, I started with him. See that? I do have one. We made some pretty significant repairs to the sawtooth in the last 5-6 years. How is this survey informing us about the condition, whereas the past surveys wouldn't have? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a great question. So these marine structures, particularly the wood ones of that era and age, are really something you got to keep an eye on pretty closely, because they can really vary in a 2-3 year window, let alone a 5 year window. So even the last time we looked at it and we repaired those things, it will be different this time, and it will be different next time. It's just you're kind of on a curve that's going fast at this point. So
let's think about long-term investment in the sawtooth. Do we have any reasonable idea about the length of life in that structure before it needs maybe just a complete replacement like we're doing over in Fairhaven?
We do. Every time we go into a condition survey, we're looking to preserve its current strength and then start to ride the whole strength down, if you will, but keeping it even so that we don't have pockets of weakness. You're right, it won't last forever, and a replacement schedule at some point needs to be considered and programmed and thought through with the rest of the harbor and that sort of thing. We're not at that point yet. Not.
Okay. It's like that old car. Eventually you get to part where you just, I'm keeping it because I'm emotionally attached to it, but it makes no financial sense. Yeah. I have one of those, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. In future replacement on this step, if we have to replace, what are we doing for piles, Adam? Are we replacing with a synthetic, or are we going to use wood, or what have we been doing?
Yeah, it's always good practice to replace piles in kind, and the reason is for structural purposes. If we put steel piles in there or concrete piles in there amidst that whole wood structure, it would tear itself apart right there because one would be more rigid than the rest. So, and it goes vice versa. So we always replace them in kind. So a wood structure like that, we're going to replace with treated wood piles.
Well, what about the UHMW type pilings I'm seeing around various harbors?
Yeah, they're very good.
The way it wiggles like the wood does?
They do, and they're actually even more wiggly. And we use a UHMW coating where we're going to wear. UHMW is very good in a wear situation. It's not very good in a structural load-up situation, such as a structural pile on the sawtooth.
You.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, that's it. It's all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks, Adam.
Forgot I was here.
You forgot he was here. Okay. I'll remind you you're here. Adam, stay there. But you know that. All right. Number two, please.
Authorize the executive director to execute a contract with Ram Construction Incorporated of Bellingham, Washington, for the GP West capping project in the amount of $1,999,473.45, plus a 15% contingency for a total authorized contract amount of $2,300,000.
So before you start, it says on my piece of paper that Adam is presenting this. Adam, was it Ron and Mike? Ram, is that what it was?
Rob and Mike.
All right. I will never think of them as Ram Construction ever ever again. It's going to be Rob and Mike.
And Adam will be presenting this. You looked down, and we did the swap, and you looked up.
Thank you.
I was miraculously here.
All right.
Brian Gowron, Director of Environmental Programs. I just wanted to take a brief moment to introduce this project, and I will hand it back to Adam to talk through the bid award and the public works process of it. But I just wanted to take a second here to discuss with the commission the fact that this really is a major milestone in the environmental cleanup of the waterfront district, you know, visually maybe more so than scale of the project, you know, compared to the $30+ million Whatcom Waterway project and the mercury removal project and the petroleum removal project that we've done to date. You know, this is going to be a visual change to the landscape down there as part of the environmental cleanup, as well as, you know, opening the site up to the GP West downtown waterfront site up to public access. It's going to be really the first major, aside from the demolition of the built structures, the first major visual structural or change in the downtown waterfront area. And I, you know, this isn't a, you know, an Academy Award acceptance speech, but I did think it was worth acknowledging that a lot of work has gone into getting us to this point. Our partners at the city, current and past commissions, you know, to make the move to acquire that property, current and past executive directors, our partners at the city and Department of Ecology, and our technical teams, our legal team, to worked on the consent decree to get us to this point. And it really has been a team effort, and I think it's something that I think is worth acknowledging as the project sponsor, to say thanks to the team that got us to this point, pending commission approval of the project, of course. And I think is going to see a major change of the landscape down there. So if you have any questions for me, I'm available. But with that, I just want to pass it back to Adam as a, you know.
Thanks, Brian.
Yeah,
thank you, Brian.
Yeah, I just want to take the moment to also say that at the staff level, head of that, obviously besides Director Fix, Brian does a fantastic job with this thing and he understands it fully. He speaks the language of these regulators, and it's refreshing that I somehow know him and he somehow understands what they're saying. So very good job, Brian. Yeah, thank you. Here we go. So this is the GP West capping project. This is a bid award for Ram Construction. The commission may remember that we just awarded the All-American Marine Construction Project to Ram also. So they are going to have between $11 and $12 million of contracting with us here through the summer, fall, and into till New Year's. The project is like Brian mentioned, is going to very much change the aesthetic and the feel of the waterfront. For the past several years, we've been hauling materials down to that site, whether we demolish them on site or even some materials we've had from other sites, such as the Whatcom Waterway project. And we've been crushing those materials and stockpiling them for this moment. And so this is what we were looking at for this project is basically two things. Let's say three things. One is we have to meet the environmental regulations put on us, and that is to establish a human contact cap between the materials that are there in the ground and what will eventually be the traveling public's footrest. The second thing we looked at was how can we make this site safe for the traveling public? Today it is not that safe. It is a forlorn industrial site with those types of hazards, foundation pieces around, loading docks around, this sort of thing. And then the third thing is that we recognize that this site may be in the condition we leave it after this project for a number of years, depending on the rate of development. So we want it to be something that is not that hard to look at, and actually something attractive to a developer, to others that would want to get involved with the site. So what you're going to see at the end of this project is a gravel fill. Essentially all these shaded areas that the commission can see here, this, for orientation, this is the granary building here. This is the Whatcom Waterway. This is the, these are the digester tanks and the alcohol plant, the board mill, and what's remaining of the chipper building is in this vicinity. So the commission can get a scale that we're covering somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 acres, and that will be a graded crushed rock, very, very foot passable, and basically this looks like it's development ready ground. We're in sync with the city of Bellingham. The next commission action is for us to do some of this work for the city, which I'll explain in the next action. But just so the commission can situate themselves with the forthcoming roads, there's Greenery Avenue and Laurel Street. Again, so this fill is synchronized with the city's work forthcoming. It's funny because we're really only doing three things to that site in this vicinity. One is remove the known contaminants, which we did with the GP West bunker dig out, the commission approved. We provide this cap as the second thing. And then the third thing is we put monitoring wells in it to monitor to see if it's naturally attenuating itself. And so this is the second big step. And as exciting as that is in Brian's world, it's kind of a rather mundane excavation project for us civil engineers.
Thank you, Sam. It doesn't take much to excite Brian.
Wow.
Anyhow, we got a very good set of bids. We had six bidders, all of them within 20% of each other. All the bids were below the engineer's estimate considerably. I will show the commission. The idea here isn't for the commission to be able to read these numbers, but I just wanted to show something. This is a bid tabulation that we put together at the end of every bid to so we can see if we have balanced bids and to analyze how our low bidder is. In these two columns is our engineer's estimate. In these two columns, sorry, here are our low bidder, and then here go our other five bidders. And in that green box, I wanted to show the commission these particular line items, and this one in particular is the veneer removal, which we can explain if you like, but essentially what I did here is total the difference between our engineer's estimate of $3.8 million to our low bid of $2 million. And you might be asking, whoa, where's the difference? Well, 1.3 of that 1.8 is shown right in these items, and almost half of it in that one single item. And all the bidders were in this same genre of bidding quantity, so it was or same pricing. So it, all to say is we feel like we have we're very confident. We have very strong bids, very strong bidders, and they were all seeing the same set of plans. So the staff is definitely recommending to proceed with the project. Do the commissioners have any questions?
Can you go back to the last slide, please? So I was noticing the numbers because they're not that tiny and I have brand new glasses. When you do sort of a postmortem on these numbers that you all put together and you see such a significant discrepancy in what you thought it would cost versus what the construction company thought it would cost, how do you reconcile those two? What do you do moving forward with that information?
Yeah. Well, it depends what we're observing. For instance, in this case, I'll go back to this just for a moment. Mm-hmm. Just this item A11 veneer removal. So our engineer thought this was going to be $250 per ton, with an estimated quantity of 3,100 tons for a total of $775,000. There could be two things I could observe with that when I analyze it. One is one bidder very high or very low, or and in which case I have to be thinking about, do we have an unbalanced bid here? Do they see something we don't? Are they trying to take advantage of something? The other thing I could be observing, though, and it was the case here, is that all of the low bidders were together, and they were all different and distinct from our engineer. I don't mind that, because essentially contractors know their business, and they know how to do it very well. And I understand the expertise of our engineers, and I understand that they're trying to suppose how they think it can get done, but the contractors really are shrewd in their industry, and that's why they survive as good contractors. Does that answer the commissioner's question?
It does. And there's two potential pitfalls. One is that you're guessing too high, which always makes it look like it's coming in better. But the other is you may miss on the wrong direction, then you're in a little bit more trouble there. Mm-hmm. So guessing too high is not as bad. It's probably, you want to get close because I think you're all professionals and you want to do your best. But it's the one that slips through that's too low. What happens if you end up, your projections come in way low, and then the contractors come back and say that's impossible?
Well,
I mean, you're going to come to the commission with that amount no matter what, right?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Well, you don't need to accept the bids, though, if they're out of line, do you?
The commissioner's correct.
Mm-hmm.
We can reject the bids if we feel we've miscommunicated or not fairly represented the work or something else. But again, we're looking at is it a pattern amidst all the bidders or is it a single bidder?
Mm-hmm.
And if it's a pattern, then we are certainly alarmed, and then we wonder whether we've communicated well.
Okay.
In this case, I have a lot of confidence in these bidders.
Sure. Yeah. Fantastic.
Any questions?
Three comments. One, that I've never seen bids that close, I don't think, since I've been a commissioner. That's really great. And
yeah.
All local guys and nice bids. On that, go back to the other picture. Those piles of rock that are all going to disappear, where are they all going?
They get fit into the wedge and then covered over. So they will be the base layer.
Okay.
Yeah. And I would like to add something to the commissioners. Something the commissioners can be very proud of is when we recycle the buildings that we took down and many of the appurtenances around that site, we boasted and were true that we recycle 95% of those buildings by weight. And this is the recycle. They are being used in this effort.
Cool.
So.
Okay. And then how soon in the gray area over here, people are going to ask once they start seeing little change down there, how soon are they going to be able to use that park?
Brian, maybe you want to answer that? Yeah, thanks.
Because that's going to be a question that's going to come up as they start to see the activity taking place.
Yeah, definitely. That's a great question. And the as Adam will talk about next, is that the Granary Avenue and Laurel Street, as well as the Whatcom Waterway Park area, which is the darker gray shading there, is work that's being done by the city. Right now, they're in their engineering and design phase, so we're right in track with this cleanup effort to get the capping done, set the stage for them to come in right behind us with their road construction and their park construction. So that their timing for those is anticipated within probably a year after we're done, the parks will be under construction. So depending on how the actual design goes, they have a basis of design where they have kind of started to program the park, what they think the main uses for that Whatcom Waterway Park will be. And now they're just right now starting the detailed design for that. But they're anticipating they'll be under construction in 2017 on that park, with it opening as soon as they can get it available. The other parts that we've talked about is, you know, there's not only the park part, but the whole site, as Adam indicated, is going to be made accessible and safe. So there's going to be much less restrictions on the site usage for interim uses, other things like that. That will have to be kind of a case-by-case decision on how we choose to use the site. But because the cleanup's being done and we're making it accessible and safe, I think we'll have a lot more opportunities to use that space in a variety of different ways for interim projects or things like that. So, yep.
Thank you.
If I could add one thing that's kind of unique about this project is that I call this environmental remediation version 3.0. Because this is the really advanced stuff that these guys do that says, look, we're going to have a materials management plan. So when someone digs a foundation to build a building, they're going to take care of what they find in their hole. And they're going to do that as part of their building construction. Under version 2.0, which we had maybe 8 to 10 years ago, we would have dug a bunch of stuff up, hauled it away, filled it with gravel. Then somebody comes in, digs a foundation, digs the gravel out. Then they haul the gravel away. It's very expensive. So this is a true brownfields approach where you have in the consent decree a materials management plan that says as you build a foundation and you find something, you take care of it, but you don't chase it beyond just what you need for your hole. And then your foundation is part of the solution. So this is really a very large-scale brownfield redevelopment, kind of the most cutting-edge way to do it. The port staff kind of put this together so that we're not wasting a lot of time digging stuff up, hauling it to Eastern Washington, putting gravel in, then digging that up, and then putting a foundation in. It's a very integrated approach when the development comes. So this just merely caps it until the developments occur.
I had a question.
Yeah, go.
The docks I see and the park and stuff there, who takes care of that? Will that be the port or the city? We're going to have a pier and docks there?
No one's committed to doing that. My guess is it'll end up being the port. I don't think you'll see a developer do that, and I don't think the city parks has the money to do it. But yeah, no one's on the hook for doing it.
Thank you.
Following on that, so I said in the past I'd love to hang on to that pier and the wharf there, the former GP property. I think we can do two things. One, we can let people on it, and it ties very well to this park, but also we can tie things up to it because it's there. So it's kind of cool. So do you have a question about the fill? And this is the image. So to the, let's just go below the granary building. It drops off pretty significantly, and the grade changes. There's a bit of a parking lot down roughly at the same grade as the railroad tracks. And it looks like on this that you're going to leave that intact?
Well, out of all the areas the commissioner had to choose, that is kind of my...
Is that just kind of a weird spot that...
It is a weird spot. But I've actually put additional quantity of gravel in the bid that once we get into this, and it's so hard to visualize, frankly, and I'm not even sure I can visualize it in its final form yet, which is really puzzling me, and I'm reluctant to spend any money on it until I really understand what we think should happen there. But I did put a quantity of gravel in this bid that I could fill this and make this kind of more blended in to the development. But it's kind of going to be one of those site when I see it and understand it.
So the Chestnut used to end there. The bridge abutment was there, so it's really built up.
Yeah,
there was a conversation at the last week of the WPPA about climate change adapting to us, among other things, sea level rise, and the Port of Bellingham was actually called out for some of the work that's happening here on a potential adapting to rising sea levels. But this rail line will be underwater, maybe. Anyway, it'll be much lower than the site. So this one in particular kind of draws attention, like what happens back there? It's just the back lot, I guess it drops off. Maybe it's, I've always thought it'd be a great place for a multi-story parking structure, so maybe it's the first floor of a parking structure and it doesn't really drop off, it's a basement, so to speak. So. Mm-hmm.
Right. Sand and palm trees? Sand and palm trees?
Sand and palm trees, yeah. Mm-hmm. You have any other questions about this?
No,
any questions? No. It's a long conversation about pushing dirt around, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the level of excitement in Brian's eyes, I got to tell you. There you go. Well, hearing no further conversation, let's vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Super. Thank you, Adam.
You're welcome.
Let's see. These are all yours. They're all engineering, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
All right, number three, please.
Authorize the executive director to execute an interlocal agreement with the City of Bellingham for the reimbursement of site grading at the Waterfront District.
Yeah, this is a rather small part. What we did with that bid, the commissioners may notice, is we segregated out a small, what we call a bid schedule, which are costs that we want to directly identify or have identified in the bid. In this case, bid schedule B is the work for the city. It totals about $27,000 and takes place in this red box shown on your drawing here. And what the commissioners should understand, of course, is that the port is only under the obligation to meet the requirements of the consent decree, which in the case of the GP site is either a cap or it's clean. The area here that we're going to be doing some grading for the city is already capped with asphalt and or it's clean. And so we have no need or obligation to touch it. However, because we're going to be filling in and smoothing in and everything else, it would be just out of place. It would be a great big hill in the middle of a smooth graded thing. And so for the city's sake, we are grading that out in our project so that their project can roll ahead easier. And in the meanwhile, between the time we're done and the time they start, there's not a drop off out there between the old Chestnut Mound and the grading that we're doing. So we put an interlocal in place where we can do the work and then submit an invoice to the city that they pay and reimburse us, essentially. It's good government.
Sounds good.
I have a question. So we're talking about the asphalt around what used to be the old Bellingham fish store around the edge of the granary there, that parking, basically the parking lot where the road used to come down. That's the gray area here.
I'm sorry. Can the commissioner ask that again, please?
That's where the road came around before. That's was the parking lot for the business that was there, the granary, Bellingham Fish Company. We're talking the solid gray is what you're speaking to, or the...
No, I understand what the commissioner's saying. It's actually right in here that Chestnut used to come down through and connect on to Central and swing around, and this was a fish market,
right,
I recall.
Right, right.
And so as you go this way on the site, there's just some drop-offs. There's, I think, a 10 or 12-foot drop somewhere in here, and it would just be kind of hazardous to leave it as is. But again, we don't have the... we don't have the impetus financially to mess with it. So, but we're going to mess with it for the city.
But we're not doing anything with the solid gray.
That's inside of Harcourt's lease. So Harcourt will be doing that work in there. Yeah. The commissioner is correct.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I think Commissioner Risco remembers Chestnut ending there at one point. You do? Yeah, I think so. Any questions or comments?
No.
All right. All in favor, say aye.
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 All right.
What a few things I can remember.
That was a long time ago. It was like 1930s or 40s or something. Number four, please.
No, it was
not quite that long ago.
Yeah, I think I've seen that.
I know.
I know.
It wasn't the 30s or the 40s. Even the crickets.
Commissioner Briscoe, when...
Oh. That just made Dan feel really old.
Authorize the executive director to execute a professional services agreement, or PSA, with Carletti Architects, PS, to provide assistance with planning, designing, and permitting the proposed improvements to the Lignum building for a total authorized amount of $140,512.
I'm not sure the commission voted on the last action. Did they? Thank you.
Did we? Yes. Yeah, we did. Oh, yeah. Okay, thanks.
Sir. Actually trying to do that. Okay, this is the, my engineer is on his way down here right now. We try to be efficient with their time, but we are a little slow on the draw getting him here on time. He'll be here in 1 minute.
Should we have that last
So that question was really just a stall.
It was.
That's where we're going.
Sure.
Can you vote again so we can get more time?
Which mound of dirt are we talking about?
Okay. The commissioners might be aware that in our 2016 capital improvement project budget is $1.5 million to do base improvements to the Lignin building. We've gone through an RFPS process, and through that process have hired Carletti Architects. I will have my engineer John Gibson explain just a little more about that and what we're looking at doing to the building.
He's coming. I can hear him.
We've been through the building a few times and have surveyed the systems in the building, both the structural. One thing important to notice about the building is that it was powered internally from Georgia Pacific by their own substation. And their own water. And so when the substation went away and the water went away, that building is now orphaned. It is just a shell sitting there without power or water. Thank you, John Gibson.
Good afternoon, commissioners. I apologize for being late. We had a fire line get hit, and I've been trying to take care of that. But please forgive my tardiness.
Yeah, so what's right. The fire line?
There's no fire. It's just at warehouse one at the BST. We're replacing the roof out there, and the man basket just happened to brush up against one of the pipes, but the system was already put in test mode, and our maintenance crew is on it.
Good.
Good job.
All bad and good.
Yeah, so look already is gone. Where'd he go?
So, commissioners, I'm John Gibson, and I'm going to be speaking about the Lignan Building improvements. As you're aware, this is located out at the GP site, close to the intersection of Maple and Cornwall. And I think as Adam was discussing when I entered, this building used to belong to Georgia Pacific. We acquired it in 2005 as part of that larger property purchase. It was formerly used for processing and packaging lignin. It's a pretty standard, pre-engineered steel building. I think you've all been inside of it. It's about 55,000 square feet. And I should just mention that it was built in two phases. The first phase was in 1964, and then in 1971, they expanded it. We're going to be looking at this building as essentially a shell that is in need of substantial basic improvements. A few of the things that it lacks at the moment are electrical service, an electrical switchboard. It needs a fire alarm system, domestic and fire water service. It needs restrooms for anybody who's working there. The ceiling is uninsulated. And then some of the existing components are also in need of updating. For instance, the heaters are old-style steam unit heaters. And that was based on some of the original infrastructure in the building. Those would need to be updated to a gas system. The photo on the right shows a sidewall ventilation fan. So those are just to expel air out. But obviously, we need to have a modern system that intakes air and expels it at the same time and conditions it accordingly. This is just a shot of some of the current insulation on the walls. As you can see, over the past 50 years, this building has had some heavy use and some of the insulation has gotten damaged, so we would need to go ahead and clean it and repair it. GP also had a rail spur leading into the building, and we don't anticipate a tenant needing that in the future. So that would be removed and filled so that there's a flat slab all the way across.
So, you know, if this building becomes an exposition hall, that's where you park the Pullman cars for the cafe. So don't get too excited about filling it.
That's a good point. Okay. We should have mentioned that to the architect
there
already.
You go. All right.
Freezer cars, right?
Or freezer cars.
Freezer
Thank cars.
You. Another example of sort of the hodgepodge nature of some of the construction, we've got a couple different styles of lighting in the building. In some parts of the building, the lighting is missing altogether. In other places, it's just a little outdated, and it's going to be hard for our maintenance crews to find the right parts to service it, and it might not be that efficient. So that's one of the things the architect will need to take a look at with their subs to make sure that we're doing the best thing possible there. On the outside of the building, it needs some attention. There's a few spots like this that need to be cleaned and repaired, but overall, not too hard of a job. So we went out to the commission, or we went out to the public for proposals in March. Carletti Architects responded to our request for public for professional services. And their professional services agreement for $140,000 includes doing an initial assessment of the building. They would go through with all of their subs, the civil engineer, mechanical engineer, electricians, and do an assessment of what's there and what still needs to be done. They would generate a report with recommendations and a cost estimate. And at that time, we would like to come back to the commission, present their findings and their recommendations, and seek further direction. We'd like to find out if what they are proposing matches the Port Commission's vision for this building, And we also want to bear in mind that ongoing discussions with potential tenants could completely change the direction of this project. So as we ask for your approval today, we do it with that understanding. Are there any questions?
Mr. Robbins?
I don't.
And Mr. Briscoe?
I do not.
All right, that was easy. I have none either. So all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And was that you running, by the way, earlier? I think we knew you were coming. Thanks for the hustle.
Sorry about that.
It's not Les Schwab, but we appreciate it. So we're a little early for our 5 o'clock break, so I asked that we're going to bump Mr. Snodgrass and the Choose Whatcom website update into this part of our meeting. I would ask Dado at 5:30 when we reconvene if you could show up in case any folks on the public want to ask you questions or whatever. Then okay. Don't anticipate that. But so let's hear about our Choose Whatcom website.
Thank you, Commissioners. Dodd Snodgrass, Economic Development Specialist. I'm here to do a drive-through of our new Choose Whatcom website. First, a little background on the project. As you know, in Whatcom County, we have a variety of business, service, economic development, workforce training partners, and we all serve different constituencies. We also work together, but often there's a perception that there's not a source to go to access all these good resources, and so there are various efforts. There was a committee that was chaired by Mayor Linville called the Business Community Solutions Group, and they convened some local business people to look at the issue from the perspective of the city about how could we market these services more effectively and in a team fashion. And also along those lines, at the port here, we have the port website, and we have an economic development section, which is loaded with lots of information. But it's not the most, I would say, graphically interesting, engaging kind of information. Plus, it's inside the port page. So we also thought, from the port perspective, we'd like to be out there and kind of sell the county better for the variety of services that we offer. So this conversion to a project, we decided that a website that we could pull together our team members and produce would be a good way to put that forward. So we did that, and we launched the website a couple weeks ago at an event at the Pickford with about 150 people. And we're just starting to get the word out and do some presentations. So I wanted to come before you and do a walkthrough. So when you come to the homepage, there's a video that just constantly runs across the front, sort of depicts different aspects of the community moving forward. Part of the website development project was a branding exercise, and we elected to select Choose Whatcom Moving Business Forward to embrace all of Whatcom County. And the notion of moving business forward is moving business forward if you choose to start a company here or move a company here, we want you in Whatcom County. And so we've got some key kind of grabbers here about some facts that, as those change, we can update those that can grab some attention. You get the option to start, grow, or relocate a business. If you scroll through, we decided to identify and prioritize some key industrial sectors. And these aren't so much what we call clusters, like cluster industries, but key areas that are important in the community. So manufacturing, food and beverage, technology, recreation, outdoor recreation, health and wellness, since that's a significant part with the hospital, agriculture, and of course, maritime. So you see these options to learn more about industries. We have the ability to load some news of interest as they come out about the business community or the community in general. We're kind of featuring Mr. Pritchett and Faith Life on the front, and then acknowledging the three funding partners for the website. So back up here at the top, so say you land on the website, say I'm interested in starting a business. You come to this page here, and some narrative here about what we're doing to offer services to help you start a business, pitching what we have to offer. And what's really interesting, so the key thing about each of these options you have is there's a support team. So these are the different, what we call Team Whatcom now, different organizations that prioritize that support. So in the start, we've got SCORE, Innovation Resource Center, and the Small Business Development Center. So those are the key organizations that help people start business. And then if you click on here, for example, should be going to the website for that organization. So that's one of the key parts here is it's not taking anything away from an organization, but give you the opportunity to access that organization for assistance. But you can also,
Dodd,
yes, sir.
Can you go back and
yeah.
What were you clicking? You were clicking through to SCORE?
Well, it just didn't come up.
Yeah, it didn't. I was trying to get, it's a little bit slow. There we go.
You know, we were talking about fiber down there, WPBA. Mm-hmm. All right, cool. So that's what we end up with when we look at that one. Okay.
Dodd, one question when you're going through this. I watched this. I took a good look at it, and I was surprised there was no voice, no music. That's on purpose, obviously.
Oh, on the homepage with the video? Yeah, that's...
For any of this. It doesn't talk about it, or...
There's sound associated with each of the videos.
Well, we're going to get to the video. I'm going to get to that part.
No, I mean when you're looking at the first page of it.
Oh, that's unintended to have music.
Okay.
I thought that would be distracting. Okay. So we hired Red Rock. They're the media, digital media company, and they kind of understand. But
I think they did a great job. Great job. I was just asking if there was supposed to be any voice at the beginning of it.
I'm glad they didn't because that annoys me, but maybe unique. I don't know.
Well, see here, I would think there would be some kind of music or talking or...
Yeah, that's the part that annoys me.
Choose Whatcom or...
Well, mostly because seriously, when you land on a page, right, you might be there for a few seconds and you're going to hear a few words at most. Nobody listens to the whole thing. So children, maybe. But
we have subliminal move to Whatcom, move to Whatcom.
Yeah, you can make it fast.
This also works on your phone, too. They did an app. It's not an app necessarily, but it's a web-based...
Mobile.
Thank you. Mobile service. So on Grow, you've got vegetable metaphor here. So just information on business advice and finding resources and talent. We have links to all the chambers in the community. And your business support team, there's CJ. There's My Big Head. And there's Tara at the City of Bellingham. So we have the ability to roll in different service providers for
grow money.
So Dodd, I know we try to be frugal money here at the port, but we can have a professional headshot taken.
Ouch. That was me in the hallway, I think.
You are way more
Tiffany.
Photogenic than I am. You're fine. Hey, can you scroll down a little bit? I want to touch my screen.
No, somebody took that photo, and I got a haircut after.
Can you scroll down a little bit on that page?
There. I want to go down to the
I want to see the list of chambers, if you will.
I thought it was an eager picture. I'm ready to go.
I think it was a
selfie. So when you're populating, when you're
not about me. Go ahead, please.
Have you all been in the mini fridge? What the hell? So when you're populating these pages with content, right, so you say join a local business group, and I see some chambers, and chambers have been around for many, many decades. So what is, for example, this list of chambers, what is that, what's the conversation that's had to decide that this is the information that you want to have on a page like this?
So let me qualify. These aren't specifically chambers. We have Sustainable Connections on here, mm-hmm. Technology Alliance Group. These are membership-based groups. So it's a good question. We have we have social membership groups. We have a lot. These are the traditional business support organizations that you can affiliate with. Yeah, if there's some others we didn't consider, we can modify that. But anything else? Okay. Also, at each page, you can get the relocation guide, and this is the publication the chamber puts out to help people, you know, learn about the community if you're going to move here, and a lot of resources. And it's a really good publication, very thorough. I think we have some advertising in it as well. I'm going to try to methodically go through each of these options here. So the relocate part, this is where you go if you're interested in, you know, expanding your company or moving your company here. So some of the key things we wanted highlighted: the infrastructure, system, Canadian location, tax incentives, these kinds of things. And there's Mr. Mishner and myself who are the points of contact for that service.
You know, Dot, I really like that one because I think that, you know, having a conversation in the last few years about Bellingham's waterfront, and for me, putting into context where Bellingham is, because I'm recalling a conversation I had maybe 15 years ago with a guy who went to Bellingham High School, and he said when they would get on the bus to go play Linden, when they got to the I-5 on Meridian, they'd turn the lights off because it was so far to Linden. You know, when you take a trip, they always turn the bus lights off, right? And it seemed like Linden was so far away. But in the context of Bellingham's geography to the Lower Mainland and to the megalopolis below us in Puget Sound, that's a really, for me specifically, it's a really good graphic to show people we're in a fantastic location.
Well, this
to
fact,
reach all of that.
The 6 million, so you draw the concentric circle. There's not really another place on the West Coast. I
mean, there isn't.
You have this catch basin of 6 million, and we're right in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always been that way. We just have to always remind people that it's a consumer market, it's a business opportunity market.
Yeah, I think the next time you get there is almost down to San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, yeah. Yeah, it's pretty unique.
Okay, so. I'll go back over here and show each of these pages. We have resources listings here. So the real estate is a connection to this prospector site that we manage, that the commercial brokers, it's populated with properties, including the ports, commercial industrial properties. And we try to highlight the developable area, development areas in the county. Waterfront District is on here, and the urban villages. Recruiting, this pertains to workforce, for example. So this is a great, we want to connect with our workforce partners, so that's WorkSource and all the universities on there. Financing, link to the Small Business Development Center Finance Guide, infrastructure. Again, there's that map again. And then Team Whatcom, here, this is where the whole... all the organizations are aggregated in here, and you can click on, say, I want to know about agriculture support. So I do that, and I search. And Northwest Ag Business Center, Sustainable Connections. I'm sure why COG is there, but we can work with that. So back here, so I'm going to go. This is the fun part. This is why we made this really interesting, if I can get back to the home page. So when you go down to the specific industries, I'll pick this one because Rob likes it. So the recreation sector, you can come here, you can read about...
You're supposed to suck up to the commission.
Why well,
it's kind of like
McCauley,
the maritime thing.
Why did you choose maritime, Don? you have all week
this,
to suck
this
up
one
to
the better, the better videos. But so we're promoting the recreation economy, and it's not just getting out and having fun in the outdoors, but basically companies that do, that manufacture, that sell, that do more recreational goods, and that's the sector we're focusing on. So in each of these, for each of the industries, we had videos produced.
We kind of wanted to get out of Seattle. We wanted to be closer to recreation and mountain biking. I was driving up quite a bit to go ride Galbraith and the local trails, and I loved it up here. So we were like, let's move the families up north, and we've never looked back. To be able to ride from our house and recreate right out of our door is priceless. My business partner, Kyle, he's a Western Washington grad. We also have two other guys that are grads, so definitely have that blood flowing in our veins. Most notably, our industrial designer, Darren Seeds, is a design graduate. And so we've been involving ourselves with the internship program there and getting some of those interns in there to kind of help out and do cool projects for us. So it's been cool to kind of utilize that resource. Their interns are at a really high level, so you actually get really good production from them. So it's been awesome. I mean, I think Bellingham is one of the best kept secrets for having an outdoor industry business. One of the big things for us has been getting key employees. Like, it's so easy to lure people to come and work for us because of Bellingham. Like, that's one of the biggest things. And I look at people from outside of the industry, everybody wants to come to Bellingham. So we have a good reputation for that. I think there's probably gonna be a little explosion of industry here. I think we're kind of getting some national recognition. A lot of people are looking for any way they can to get here. I tell people all the time, I'm like, why aren't you running your company in Bellingham?
Love that guy.
So, yeah, we'll do that. So, this is great. So, this was a project. Sustainable Connections actually managed this for the city, and it's the city's contribution to the project. So, these were done. This was an initial project to highlight local industries, and we were able to integrate it into the website and have a video made for each of the sectors. And so if we go to maritime, you can read, you know, about why we're such a hot spot for maritime trades. We have some quotes here. We also, besides the videos, Brian Pemberton did an excellent testimonial about the port and doing business here in Bellingham. And this is our maritime video.
Well, the beauty that we have in the marines trade industry here in Whatcom County is that just literally outside our door is Bellingham Bay and the gateway to the San Juan Islands and the Puget Sound. And, you know, there's been a thriving business here for years in the marine trade sector. All American Marine's market segment ranges from building ferry boats, eco-tour boats, water taxis, survey boats, and research boats. We're focused on innovative technology that includes ultra-low wake wash boats, high fuel efficiency, and we're even starting to look at hybrid propulsion systems. And we feel like there's good local support. The Port of Bellingham, we're working very closely with them. And most recently, we're just finalizing the plans and specifications for a new fabrication building down at Squalicum Harbor. But we're definitely in growth mode. As far as a capital to expand, it's with partners like the Port that will help us get into the a new fabrication facility. The Port's also helped us with some of the small shipyard grants. It's out of the Maritime Administration. So we've been able to get $1.6 million of grant money for buying new state-of-the-art equipment. Well, what I think is really good about working here in Bellingham and Whatcom County is, the relationships that you develop. When I call somebody at the port or the city, I know them, and they know me. And yeah, this area attracts a lot of people who want to see their quality of life improve. And as a result, I believe we're able to get some of the best workers in the industry, and I'd put our guys up to anybody.
There's a bar in Seattle called Doc Maynard's, right?
I don't know.
There is.
Apparently.
There is.
I thought it was like a baseball game. I don't know about bars.
Oh. I'm a creep.
So I want to show you all the videos. We have one associated with each of these industries. And over time, we've talked about maybe an education video that we could promote all the schools. We could roll in another company. But we're really, really impressed with the quality of the video production for this. Then there's a lifestyle button, just promote things to do.
All right, I have an answer to the question. Doc Swinson, Doc Maynard, was an American pioneer, doctor, and businessman. He was one of Seattle's primary founders. He was an effective civic booster and, compared to other white settlers, a relative advocate of Native American rights.
You know that.
Now you know.
So, Dodd, when this launched, a question came up about the, you know, lack of multicultural imagery on this. Diversity is not really high. Has this, this has obviously been a conversation that's happened over the last week or so. What's the way forward on that?
Right. So, and we had a discussion about our team Watcom meeting. We want to be, you know, respectful and show in terms of cultural makeup and in the business community and economic development. So one of the things we're going to look at, we're in discussion with the Lummi Nation. We were going to have some information on their economic development program and maybe some cultural information, discussion of things like highlighting some business success stories, elements in the agricultural industry. So the content can grow and change over time. So,
Second question I got is about content. Who manages this and how is it paid for?
So, I am the web manager.
Okay. So that's how it's paid for. Okay.
So, it's fairly. So the content I've done some. It's fairly straightforward, and the pictures and things like that we can work with. The architecture is pretty much designed by Red Rock. We have some funding to do some maintenance, and we're going to budget some more next year for some things and other elements we want to take care of. One of the key things to make a website effective is the site optimization, this SEO, site search engine optimization, excuse me. So the more we can get people to post the website on different pages and search it, the more it'll show up in searches. So we did some media releases. We're getting the website out on some print material. We have a display at the airport that we just produced, and we thought it'd be a good place to set up. So we have a Choose Watcom display there in the baggage area. So and so we're gonna be the manager of that, but the city and the county have been great partners, and they'll continue to partner with us next year.
Any thoughts on this?
Well, I think Tyler Burton is staff there at Red Rock have done an excellent job. I really like the website.
Good job.
All right. Thank you.
Update. And some
team effort.
We'll see how it goes. Thank you.
So we're going to recess for our dinner recess because I'm starving. I'm going to eat my cookie. And we'll be back at 5:30. We'll start with public comment and then an update on SKEDC and any new board or committee business or commission business. All right.
This is a bar in your square called Backrooms.
Just knew the name for some reason.
Lyons, congratulations to those who don't know that our legal eagle over here, Frank's son, is now a commissioned second lieutenant in the United States Army. So thanks for the stories and congratulations, Frank.
Yep, here, here.
All right, it is 5:30. We're going to start with our public comment period. So if there's anybody that wants to say anything.
Again, we've had no sign up tonight.
Anybody?
Nobody?
All right, then we will move on to the only item remaining on our regular agenda, which is Miss Tiffany DeSimone. Is it D or Day?
Simone.
DeSimone. All right, we're going to hear a little bit about the Ski to See.
DeSimone, Meetings and Event Supervisor. Sorry to make you all return for this one little Ski to See update. However, it is the fun stuff.
Well, actually, this is awesome because otherwise we would be here for no public comment and then be done. So awkward. At least this is purpose. Thank you.
So I just wanted to take this opportunity in an effort as we do these community outreach events and as I'm getting more spun up in my position and sort of getting things, I think, under control, take the opportunity so that the commissioners know that these things are happening on the waterfront. When you get questions from the community or people wonder what's happening and what's going on next. So I have asked the gentleman from Whatcom Events to come and give a little update about the Ski to See. As you all know, I'm sure the port has supported it for its entirety, I think. And it spans across lots of our property and our waterfront, and we think it's good for economic development and for community outreach and drawing people down to these lovely spaces that we manage. So it's Curtis Anson is the race director. He was new last year for Ski to See, and Mike Trowbridge, who is vice president of the board of directors for Whatcom Events and is new this year. So I'll let them take it.
Yeah, I remember the Port of Bellingham train collecting the first runners back in the 1920s. That was amazing.
Wow.
You know, there was no Port of Bellingham train, you guys.
Were you sitting in the bleachers or were you running?
You just remember the photo of the guy with the cow? That was a Port of Bellingham train. No.
Thank you. Thanks for staying.
I was in the bleachers.
We appreciate it. As Tiffany said, I'm vice president of Whatcom Events. I've been in that position for, I think, 3 or 4 years now. Whatcom Events was formed 5 years ago or so as a nonprofit. We're a 501c4 nonprofit that was formed by Pete Coy, Duncan Howitt, to take on the Ski to See race from the group that had it previously in order to bring the race to Whatcom County and to make it everything that they felt that it could be. Our organizational structure is that we have the 501c4. We do the Ski to See race. We also do the, previously it was called Muds to Suds, now called Wonder Mud race, which we do out at Hovander Park. And then we do the Tour to Whatcom bicycle event, which is a 25, 50, 60, or 100 mile cycling event through Whatcom County. Since we are organized as a 501c4, we do give profits back to the community. Past 2 years, we've given away about $45,000 total. In 2014, it was a little over $33,000. Last year, with the snowpack and the changes to the race, we gave away about a little less than $12,000 back to the community. Beneficiaries have been the Boys and Girls Club of Whatcom County, the Whatcom Mountain Bike Coalition, Lydia Place, and then kind of going with our mission of supporting the communities that our events touch. We've given back to the Bellingham, Ferndale, Linden, Nooksack, Valley Food Banks, trying to concentrate on the East County, North County, and specifically earmarking our Boys and Girls Club funds for Ferndale, who's a big supporter of what we've done and where a lot of our events run through. This is my first year being, my title is executive director for the Ski to See race. I'm a volunteer, have been with all of my time at Whatcom Events. We put together a small group this year as I was taking on that position to really figure out, why are we all here? We have so many volunteers and so many people who put a lot of time and commitment into the race uncompensated. We have 1.5 employees. Curtis is full-time. We also have a part-time administrative assistant that helps him out. And then we take on a couple of interns throughout the year who fulfill the tasks like getting us volunteers, organizing our special events, those sorts of things. As part of the group that we brought together, we came up with a mission statement for Ski to Sea and for Whatcom events, which is continuing the tradition of hosting a world-class event that inspires participation and community-centered competitive fun in the unique environment that is Whatcom County. And really, our whole goal is to promote Whatcom County. I'm a lifelong Whatcom County resident, and to promote all of the amazing opportunities that Whatcom County has to offer, both keeping the local culture going and bringing people in from outside. So along those lines, we'd really like to thank you for allowing us to use the properties and allowing us to highlight those great spaces that you have. Things like Tiffany bringing us in this year for using the ferry terminal for our pack-up pickup. That goes a lot towards our mission of highlighting the great places in Whatcom County and bringing people to those places and showing it to them. We've had a good relationship over the years working with the various people, starting with Marie Duckworth now at the airport, and the last couple of years working with Tiffany has been great. Logistical side, working in the meetings, it's been very, very useful. Thank you a lot for the in-kind sponsorships that you guys have given us over the years, and we really appreciate the amount of work that your rank and file staff all the way up to you contribute to it. Now Curtis is going to talk.
All right. Good evening. Yeah, part of the appreciation that we show all of our sponsors, including the Port of Bellingham, is we have a sponsorship appreciation dinner, which I believe all of you have received e-vites. You are all welcome. I just want to remind you of that. That is going to be held on Wednesday, the 25th. At the Upfront Theater. It's going to be just the time. We'll have it's catered food, some drinks, and just some live entertainment, comedic entertainment. Keep it kind of light, keep it fun. So I just wanted to remind you guys that you guys are more than welcome to attend that. I wanted to go over some things that will be new to the race in 2016. As you might recall, there was an unprecedented lack of snow in 2015. That was interesting for my first year as race director. Kind of the title line that went with this year is "The Snowpack is Back," which I thought was pretty clever, and it was okay to poke fun of ourselves a little bit. So in light of that, we are going back to high-level snowpack this year and a great year at the Mountbaker Ski Area. We're going back to the classic ski-to-ski course, which will include the cross-country ski and downhill ski or snowboard, and we'll end at Marine Park with a kayak. Another thing that's new to 2016 is another tagline we came up with is "The Beach is Back." We're at Squalicum Beach, right over here. In years past, they had to run along that course and or biked or ran across that course and finished right on Rotor here and went right into Zwanish Point Park to exchange with the kayak. There had been a few different names we had for that course. One was Mountain Bike Course, and kind of the joke there was that the only mountain part about it is when you're mounting your bike. And it's also been called the Cross Country Bike, and neither one of those seemed terribly appropriate. So we went Cyclocross Bike, which actually has its roots in Belgium, which is obstacle-style biking. A lot of forced dismount areas, throw your bike on your shoulder, run, and it's really just a ton of fun. So we've incorporated that into the race this year, and hopefully that name will stick, and people will get a kick out of it this year, which I really think they will.
Another thing that we're doing this year, it's kind of cool, you may have seen some of this, we're pushing it pretty hard through our newsletter and through Facebook and Twitter and things like that. It's called Meet the Teams. It's just a short documentary of, this year we selected three separate teams to kind of feature, you know, what does this race mean to you? Why do you do it? Why are you here? And this year we featured three teams, like I had mentioned, Colchin Cycles, which is a team of Whatcom County women. I'm sure many of you know them personally. They're very hardcore and very good. We're also featuring a team called Van Damage, which is a team of former Western industrial design students, I believe, and they live in the Pacific Northwest regionally, and they come back every year, get a kick out of it, just slowly picking away at those top teams and going for a top 10 finish this year. And the last team that, we're featuring in the Meet the Teams is a team called Allenators, which is one of our family divisions, one of my favorite divisions of the race, and it's the first year in the race, and that release is coming on Friday, and I encourage you all to check it out. Very heartwarming story, at least from what I've seen so far. As far as numbers this year, we are currently 371 registered teams. The anticipation is approximately 400. That's what we're looking for this year. We've ordered that many shirts, that many race bibs, and so that's what we're looking at in terms of numbers for this year. With 400 teams, 8 people per team, that's 3,200 total racers, several of them coming from out of state and out of county, coming to see Bellingham and Whatcom County. I did want to touch on volunteering and how so much of our organization resolves around volunteering. Like Mike mentioned, there's 1.5, including myself, 1.5 paid employees at Whatcom events. Everybody, the executive director, the board of directors, all the race committee leg chairs, everybody you see on the race course is completely volunteer-based, and I'd like to recognize them today as well. Our volunteer coordinator, her name is Juliana Jenkins. She is an intern. She's a junior at Western Washington University, and she is a recreation major, and she's just gone above and beyond. I wanted to recognize her today as well. As you may be aware, there's over 1,000 volunteers to make this race happen. That's an incredible number. And yeah, right. And getting all those people together from in the same place at the same time and coordinate that, it's a tough job, and she's done a tremendous job. One thing that's kind of cool about this race and and how the volunteers are a part of that race is the community impact that it has, and people really come together. I've heard stories of people becoming lifelong friends because they met volunteering for the Ski-to-Sea race. A big part of what Juliana's done is the easiest way to go about it is contacting groups, municipality groups, church groups. There's a few Western club teams. Some of those include CTK, Mosaic Church, A Life Church. For example, CTK, they're the crew you see up at the road bike exchange at the DOT station. A lot of times it's the same people you see back there every year. They just get a kick out of it. Also from the university club teams, the men's wrestling club team, the women's lacrosse, and the women's volleyball team, and that's been a great resource for them. It's a great way for college students to get something on their resume, being involved with this race, and having volunteer experience, which is really valuable to pursuing their forthcoming careers. That's all I've got in terms of what's new for 2016 this year. I did want to reiterate our appreciation to the Port of Bellingham and all the council members and commissioners for all the great work, and for Tiffany as well for being an active member in the race committee meeting. And that's all I've got, and I'd be happy to answer some questions if any of you have any.
Nothing? Pretty good. A big thank you to all the volunteers.
Absolutely.
You bet. What's the maximum number of teams you can have? Wasn't there a limit at one time?
We do have a semi-self-regulated cap of 500 teams.
Okay. And have you ever reached that?
They have in 2011 and 2012. And they were at that time they had to put on a waiting list for teams to enter the race. That'd be a problem I'd like to have, but that doesn't seem to be the case this year. But it has reached up to 500 teams in the past, yes.
So the first time I saw this, the volunteer effort, I was asked to just watch the Twilight Crit down in Athens. And so at the time, it was still the largest crit in the nation. And then when I found out how many volunteers it took, I was just blown away because it's a multi-day event. And it's so amazing that many people come out and help with the Ski to Sea because it's such a it is fun. I volunteer now, but not with the Ski to Sea, but it's always fun.
It is amazing to see the generosity people have in the community to come together and be part of something. And, you know, part of the recruiting tool that we use, too, is, hey, if you are not a race caliber person or racing doesn't interest you, you can still be a part of this awesome race by coming out and volunteering.
The energy is huge on race day.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's cool. I had a question for you about the ending of the race at Marine Park. I know there was a couple of years ago, there was some consternation about that and space constraints and everything. Is it still working for you, or are you still thinking of maybe a different ending point would be better for the future?
At this point, it's working for us. I know logistically, we would love to have some sort of dedicated Wi-Fi down there and more power. We end up bringing in generators on race day because the power infrastructure down there can't keep up with what we've got going on. And we would love to have data. We do use a lot of data for timing and results and those sorts of things down there. That would be a huge help to us. One of the things that I've been really working on and we're working on organizationally is really working with community partners and being more transparent and more community outreach. And that includes, we've been having a lot of good conversations with the Fairhaven Merchants and the Historic Fairhaven Association. And at this point, we verbally said, hey, we want to make this work. We want to be in Fairhaven. We want to use Marine Park. And so I don't see us moving away from that, with where we're at. Now, would we love the infrastructure upgrades? Sure. Is it really tight to put that many people in that park? Yeah, but we manage. It works.
Hey, Rob, we don't have fiber down at the cruise terminal over there, do we?
I believe there's a fiber connection at the cruise terminal, so probably can't get anything done this year, but by next year I'll have the IT guys look at doing something over there for the day. Yeah.
It's not that big a stretch to drag it over.
Yeah, no, just a couple of repeaters to get a signal over there.
Yeah. We diligently to spread it that way.
Spread it that way.
Slowly but surely it's happening.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, and we appreciate that. We'd love to have that conversation of we've got a dedicated timing and IT team of four guys that are really top-notch.
Yeah, that's good to know. I mean, the Ski to Sea has, a clear national presence, but probably an international presence as well. So it's small adjustments. If we can help out with that, that'd be great.
Thanks. Yeah, like I said, we're trying to be both regional and world-class. Yeah. That's our goal with where we're going.
Super cool. Anything further from you? No? When's the parade? This Sunday? Next
the junior parade is this weekend.
This weekend?
And the Ski to Sea parade, as it's called, Blossom Time Parade, is the Saturday before the race.
Saturday before the race.
Yeah, those events are actually put on by the Bellingham Chamber of Commerce. But yes, I believe the junior is this weekend, and the Ski to Sea Blossom Time Parade is the Saturday before the race. Cool.
Junior parade is Friday night. Junior race is Saturday.
Where's the junior race?
That's Padden.
Still Padden? Okay. Yeah. All right. I don't have children. Can you tell? Or no? Have fun, kids.
Thanks for all your efforts. You know, you really bring a lot of people to the community. I don't think there's any event that brings more people to the community. And thanks for all your efforts.
Did you notice the race director's a volunteer? And I don't know what a race director does. So where you find the time, my friend, I don't know. What you do. No.
Being straight up a volunteer, it's been a lot of meetings since we started pretty hard in January, trying to get a hold of ahead of the curve on everything, and it's been.
Do you have a drone again this year?
Yes, with the meet the teams, we're going to be doing essentially more footage for the mini documentaries, and they'll be doing drone footage.
I rode up on your bus last year, and that was really pretty cool watching all that.
But you rode on the VIP bus. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah, part of the documentary team that we're doing, they are going to be featuring the teams I had mentioned on the race course, and part of the documentary team will have the aerial coverage again.
Yeah, well, that was fun. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Do you have that bus again this year?
We aren't doing the VIP bus this year.
Oh, I was going to put this guy needs to be on it. That's something else. I wish everybody had an opportunity to experience that because you get to see the start of, well, people who are watching might not know this, but you get to see the start of everything. And that you just can't. You can't. It's not even possible because you can't. Because you literally aren't allowed to go do that. So that's the only way to see that. It's pretty cool. It's a pretty cool day. So. For somebody who used to be a racer, it was really hard to not want to go race, but sitting in that bus, it was really cool. So, yeah.
How much more power do you need over there?
Top of my head, I can't tell you how many amps.
Are you bringing in quite a few generators? Or?
Quite a few, yeah. I don't know the exact specifications of the generators, but Birch Equipment is also a key sponsor of ours, and they've supplied the generators as part of the sponsorship in the past. But yeah, there are quite a few generators that are down there, mostly to power the food vendors in the vendor row there. So.
Okay. We can definitely get you specs on how many kWs of power we're currently using to keep up with everything.
You gonna park your boat out there and just...
You know, I'm going to cover all that ground over there with all that dirt coming right over to there. You could put a power underground power right across.
Can I interrupt? So we are working. So we are working on the power and the electricity down there currently, but it's not quite solved yet. We hope it'll be solved by the time these guys show up. But there's going to be generators for backup because last year we had a little power issue. So we're working on it.
Okay.
I like how you elbowed your way in there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Excuse
that was
me.
Good.
One of these.
Yeah. Well, thanks, fellas. That was,
thank you.
That's good.
Thank you.
That's good info. Rob, we had a fire truck from the airport in a parade once. We still doing that?
Well, I don't know if we are this year, but I will find out. Fire truck in the parade. We've used the fire truck from the airport in the parade in years past, but it doesn't look like we're doing so this year.
Please don't tell me it's because we don't have the licensed driver.
No. Elizabeth Monahan, Director of Human Resources. So that's usually the employee committee that kind of manages that. And this year there really wasn't that much interest to do it again.
I put my $5 in every month. Can I vote yes?
Well, the other option that we're doing is we're going to go to Ferndale and help build the Star Park out there. So those were kind of close activities, and the employee committee decided we'd go do some volunteer work at the Ferndale Star Park instead of the parade.
Let me see, hammer or ride on the fire truck? I didn't know that was an option.
We can do both.
And then I volunteered.
Last year, I think the fire truck didn't start or something.
Last year, the fire truck had a little problem, yeah. We turned on too many bells and whistles, and too many people came and played with it, and we ran the batteries down. And so it stayed on Alabama.
We pushed it home?
We had a dead fire truck for the entire day. It wasn't a good representation of the port.
Oh.
But we won an award.
And it didn't even go anywhere. I know.
It didn't go anywhere.
That was awesome. All right. Well, if we ever surplus one of those, I might buy it and put it in parade.
And what? We put a panel thing on the back?
I entered the Ski to See parade on my own. My first year, I had a Segway. I just joined the parade. Nobody said a word, and I just screwed around. Yeah, I know I'm a nerd. But okay.
You have correct permits?
No, I had nothing. I just started in the parade.
There's a picture of a guy in a Segway wanted. And
that was probably me, yeah. That's it. That is our agenda for the day. We have new business. Anything, Ms. Briscoe, Mr. Robbins?
Well, let me look at the note here.
I have one. While Bobby's looking that up, we had the sale of that fishing vessel that we held up for 30 days. As I reread that, it looked like it would automatically be sold, didn't have to come back before the commission. Did they? Is that going to be sold, or did they take care of it?
I don't have a status update for you, but your interpretation of that's correct, that we weren't coming back to the commission. The staff was just going to handle it. So I'll find out and get back to you.
I don't believe anything's been done yet, Dan. I guess I'm going to defer to you.
So I'm having, I'm going to start with this industrial development district idea that I've been throwing around for a while, and I'm hoping to find some interest from Dan and Bobby to see if we should move forward in a discussion about if this is the direction we would like to go as far as helping the east part of our county with some job development out there. So if it is interesting at all, then maybe we could have Rob find some staff time and we can start taking a look at that. And I can fill you in more if you want more.
Please do.
So the port, and Frank, you probably jump in here because I know you'll want to. The ports has the ports in Washington can create industrial development districts, and they had a one-time, some of the smaller ports could do this more than once. They had a one-time opportunity to levy a special tax without asking the taxpayers. This port already did that, and I think it was in the 80s?
Built
Squalicum Harbor. So we can't levy the tax anymore, but we still have the ability to create industrial development districts. So the RCW allows us to do that. In this particular case, I'd like to look at a small piece of property out in Kendall. It's already zoned appropriately for this, and the county's council has recognized for several decades now in their comp plan that, and this is why they zone this property that way, that they would like to see some more industrial development out there. There's the Woodland, Foothills Woodland Co-op. It's a new organization growing in Skagit and Whatcom County, and I think some of what they're doing would dovetail well with some job creation out there, and we could use this property to help spur them forward.
You're talking Kendall, did you say?
It's in Kendall, yeah. Yeah, it's not super awesome close to the border, but I do think it offers some opportunity, and since it's already been recognized by the county council as a place that they would like to see some job creation, then I think it fits well, and it would obviously give us an opportunity to do something in the east end of the county. So the last time we even talked about east was a hotel. Do you remember that conversation? Dodd was there. We were out there at Glacier that day.
The EB-5 project.
Yeah, the EB-5 project. So some a person wanting to move into the United States, and we're going to build a hotel, sort of a resort or something like that. But that, I don't think that ever happened. So there aren't a lot of opportunities for us to do things.
What are we talking as far as staff time? What would be done?
RCW... Chapter 53.25 allows port districts to form industrial development districts. You do so by, it's a geographic boundary where you determine there are marginal lands inside the boundary. And the definition of marginal lands is quite broad. So you hold a public hearing and you follow the steps and then you create marginal land, you create industrial development district. Once you do that, then the port has a lot of powers. Inside the industrial development district, it can expend funds to improve the district. It can impose what looks like a levy on all the property owners, say for a street or a sewer or electrical distribution. It can take property by condemnation. It can accept property from the county. It doesn't have to do any of these things. It can just expend funds to expand or organize the district. And then once you sell property in an industrial development district, the port owns property, can sell it, subject to reversion, for example, that somebody has to use it for industrial purposes. So it's really a very big tool that ports use. Commissioner McCauley was correct. It was linked to two six-year periods of time in which taxes could be collected. The Port of Bellingham has already used those industrial development district funds as I understand, before my time, to build Squalicum Harbor. So you could go out to the county and identify a geographic area where you believe, after a public hearing, the lands need to be organized or marginal, and then create the district.
Is this what we did in Sumas?
No, in Sumas, I should say I don't think so. In Sumas, it was essentially the same process. The port acquired a big piece of property in Sumas, then organized it into parcels, built a heavy lift industrial road so that Canadian trucks that weigh more than our roads allow could cross onto the property, and then basically sold the property off where now leases. I think there's some parcels you still lease, Mr. Fix. Mm-hmm. But one of those tenants is thinking of buying the property. So you could do essentially the same thing in an industrial development district. It just gives you a bit more authority to act with regard to the area you determined to act in.
So if there's a tax levied, it's in the area?
We won't have a tax levy. We don't have that option. We've already...
We don't have a tax levy. Industrial development districts allowed you to levy the entire
county
port. Mm-hmm. But you could create a local improvement district tax. So, for example, you could tax all the property to create a road. That's different, though, than the industrial development district taxes. That's just... It's like what cities do for sewer or water. They create an LID, local improvement district. It's very similar to that. Don't have to, though.
So do we have a particular industry that's looking at that area, or is this, has there been an interest, or is this something that will build and hopefully, or will organize and hopefully Seminole.
So the first thing that popped into my mind on this was a conversation I had about 4 years ago, and you may have heard me talk about wood pellet production out there. So there's a group that's been focused originally on the air quality, and they're getting air quality grants from state, local, and federal agencies to help with the when there's an inversion of air in the Kendall Valley, or Columbia Valley, which is Kendall, the air quality just goes down terribly. And the intent of those grants was to help people upgrade fireplaces and wood stoves and provide them with clean fuel. So right now, what they do is they typically operate through the Opportunity Council, and people buy Presto logs and that sort of thing. So the initial effort was to get people to stop buying Presto logs and buy locally produced firewood, which is already there. But
oh, thank you.
Who was that guy running for president and was drinking the water? Marco Rubio, remember? He gave the response. You guys don't remember? Anyway. Anyway, so then this conversation about, all right, we've got firewood producers out there. How do we get them engaged to help these folks who otherwise can't afford firewood to burn clean, dry firewood? So then this firewood exchange program got started, and then there was a talk of a big building so that firewood producers could come in, and they would have a pool of firewood, and that firewood would then be sold off through different programs to the locals out there. And this was, it essentially started to morph into a job creation program for firewood producers. So when I got engaged, I wasn't interested, obviously, as a port commissioner in air quality so much out there as when they started talking about firewood production and improving that. So if you look at the amount of biomass availability out in the county, it's not all firewood, but there's plenty of leftover slash and that sort of thing from logging. So the logical extension of that, which we've got a conversation with a potential pellet producer here, is that it could be used for pellet production, which in this case would be a production facility that would be a brand new thing. That made me start thinking, how can we help spur that on? If you look down at Hayless and Centralia, and especially Centralia, they've been using their industrial development districts, which are fairly new for them. And I can tell you that when I was a kid, there was a farm that I worked on. And now if you drive to that farm, all you see is the industrial development district. There's no farm left. There was the biggest dairy in the county is now the Port of Centralia. So they're leveraging this very well to bring in businesses that never existed in Lewis County. So I think there may be a small possibility for us to take a look at what's happening in the East End and help kick something off there. And again, right now, it'd just be preliminary. What would it take to do the IDD, and what sort of industry would we be able to promote out there and help get girl?
So I've made a note, and I'll get some staff looking at this, figure out how much time it takes and what the process is, and we'll report back to you.
Sure. So that's that. If you guys are up for it,
I'll move ahead. Anything we can do to help the county get some more jobs and industry moving.
And I guess the question is, how much staff time are we going to devote to this?
Yeah, I don't know what it takes to establish a district, but that's why I'm saying I'll put this together.
That's what you'll get back with.
Yeah, and I'll come back to the commission and say, here's our proposal on how to get this done.
Yeah, I think 2 years ago, Dodd's gone now, but 2 years ago we had a $10,000 grant. Oh, Sylvia's here. Can you refresh us on what that was for?
Sylvia Goodwin, planning and economic. Whoa, bit of a backfire here. We did have a proposal by Paul Schisler and I believe it was Phil Cloward, who wanted to do a project like this. We offered grant money. We told them what all they really needed to do was get together a scope of work, come up with an organization, a nonprofit that was eligible to receive the money. And they weren't able to do that. So it's a great idea. We've got some studies. We've got some background information. They produced a bunch of information, but they did not produce a scope of work with a product, and they did not come up with an organization that could accept the money and spend the money. They said, well, maybe the Opportunity Council could do it, and maybe they could do this or that, but they didn't. So that's as far as the project went. But it is a good idea, and we've got background on it.
Yeah, the advantage now is that the Woodland, Foothills Woodland Co-op, is a legitimate group. So I think that there's an opportunity that what didn't exist before. So. And the other thing is last our last meeting, there was a conversation about the board mill, the Harcourt MDA, and my assertion that the MDA assumed a construction of a building within the 18 acres that we talked about originally, and that the board mill is outside of that. So in the interim, or I think maybe just shortly before that meeting, Western Crossing had a meeting. Western Crossing didn't have any heartache with this program, but that's outside of that agreement the port has as a part of Western Crossing is different than the MDA that we have with Harcourt. So I think that we should all have a very good conversation about the future of the board mill and what Western Crossing has discussed, and not just automatically assign whatever Western wants to do with the project moving forward to whatever that committee thought that was the right way forward. Especially since there seems to be this confusion that the second structure that Harcourt wants to do could easily be the board mill, and I'm not saying it can't, but we don't have an agreement to do that. So I think we need to take a good hard look at the Harcourt MDA, what the intent was there, and whether or not the board mill fits into the commission's intent for what Harcourt should be doing with us. And also have a conversation about the board mill. There were some people thinking that it should be torn down. It doesn't have to be torn down. I obviously have some things that I would like to see happen with the building, but we definitely have to have a conversation about the board mill, and I'd like to do that as soon as possible.
There's a couple things need to happen here, Commission, that the Commission needs to approve or to give their thoughts for going forward. One, you're correct about the Western Crossing Board meeting. The other pieces of that, the Western Crossing Board, as you know, is two members from the port, two members from Western, and one independent from the community. The other pieces that need to tag on to that are, one, the Port Commission needs to approve the same Western Crossing proposal that the Western Crossing Board approved, and the Board of Trustees at Western also need to approve that. It's a three-party agreement, so without all three parties agreeing to it, it's null and void. So only one step of that three-step process has occurred, so the other step needs to come to you. The other thing that needs to occur is the MDA with Harcourt needs to be modified to include the board mill building, if indeed that's what the Port Commission wants to do, and that's what Harcourt wants to do as their second project, because you're correct, it's not currently in their developable acreage. That one's going to take a little longer to get it together, but you're going to see a little more action on that in the coming probably 30 days as well. Harcourt's ramping up their activity on the granary building. The city and I have been telling Harcourt that they have to get that granary building going before we'll entertain discussions about a second building, and that's part of the holdup for the second building planning is the fact that the granary building hasn't started yet.
Anything you wanted?
No, that's a good explanation.
Can I? I guess it would be all three of us. Can you share with us the port's role in Western Crossing? Any agreements, documents, whatever that whole thing is set up? I haven't seen it in quite a while. Any MOUs or anything that go along with that?
It's the Western Crossing Agreement is just an MOU, I believe. Well, it's an interlocal. It's an interlocal agreement between the two governments.
All right.
It's a document that was approved in 2010, I believe, 2011, by the Port Commission. The Western Crossing Board meets once a year just to discuss the development of the western 6 acres on that site. Right now, the agreement calls for the port to put approximately 6 acres into Western Crossing, and for Western itself to sell some acreage it has out on Bakerview and Hannigan and take the proceeds from that sale and put it into Western Crossing. We don't expect the transactions to be even. At the end of the day, your equity in Western Crossing is equal to what you've contributed to. So if we contribute 6 acres valued at X, we get X value, and if they contribute cash from their sale valued at Y, they have Y value, and those things aren't necessarily 50-50, if that makes sense. That's the agreement in a nutshell, a very summary version of the agreement, but all transactions for Western Crossing need to be approved by the Port Commission, and that's the step that's missing here.
That'd be great. So if we can get any of the agreement paperwork?
Yeah, I can circulate those. Right, sure.
Copies, yeah. I haven't seen it in quite a while, and I don't know what I do with copies.
I will recirculate the 2010 agreements to you. Yeah.
All right. That's it for me. Anything further? No. Mr. Briscoe?
Well, some of the stuff in our updates that's coming up. That now or until it's in front of us, the various things.
If you got some items you want to talk about,
Well, I had one. I was looking at one thing with their finance charge rates. The one gentleman would be Blaine Marines, BMS. And I was kind of curious why we're at 5% on our late fee charges. We're at 5% on some of the stuff and 1% on the other. And I was looking at our prime rates, and we're at 3.5% on prime rate today. I know I look back when the prime rate was, or this was set, the prime rate was 8.5%. So what's it been, 10 years now? We didn't adjust down. I mean, I was curious how that.
I don't think
set.
I don't think it's intended to equal lost opportunity cost of money or equal interest. It's supposed to be a penalty. It's supposed to encourage people to pay their bills on time. So there is a time value of money component in there, certainly, and that's where the interest could come into play. But it's also just an incentive for people to pay their bills on time, not to have to incur a late fee.
So the 5% was just kind of pulled out of.
I believe so. Yes.
Is Shirley? Is that a late fee? You're talking about Blaine Marine Services, right? Talking about Blaine Marine Services.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that pretty standard across all the leases that we put out there? Is a 5% penalty for or a 5% late fee? I know that there's a lot of leeway in how you write these leases, but some of it's probably standard, right?
Shirley McFerrin, Real Estate Director. There was actually a change to our lease late fees back in 2006. My predecessor brought forward a resolution to change the late fee structure. And I'm looking at it with Tamara because it is a bit, it's a bit of an administrative nightmare because we have some leases at 1%. We have some at 5%. But one thing I will tell you about one of our tenants that we're referring to is that this is a tenant that, you know, has a history of delinquency. So I'm meeting with him tomorrow to discuss that, and we'll come back and talk to the commission a little more about this.
I was curious why we're at the 1 and 5, why the discrepancies.
There is a discrepancy that is true. Some when the resolution was done in 2006, leases were modified, and as we renewed leases, the new language was put into the leases. So some of them that have not been renewed or modified have the old language. Some have the new, and we are actually doing some manual changes on a pretty regular basis from an accounting standpoint to make sure that the leases, whatever the late charge being charged, is consistent with the contractual arrangement. And in this case, our tenant did sign a renewal and modification that increased the late fees.
No, I wasn't. I was just trying to get at why we were different rates.
Yeah, and we are inconsistent, and we are reviewing it. So I really appreciate that comment.
But it sounds like the reason we're inconsistent is because some of the leases have come up for renewal or renegotiation, so therefore they've got the 5%, and some of the older leases haven't been renegotiated, therefore they've got the 1%.
That's correct.
So that was my question. Since 2006, all new leases we've signed, or most new leases we've signed, have the 5% in them, is that correct?
I would say nearly every new lease has that new language. And then as we do renewals and modifications, we talk with our tenants and we say of what we are updating the language. And when a lease is renewed or modified, we insert the new language. But we're not there with every 300 contracts.
Well, if they signed a lease with a couple 10-year options or something, and the only thing that was going to be negotiated was the price, then that would stay at the 1% in the new lease because you're not renegotiating that part of it.
Well,
we when we renegotiate our leases, we try to update the language, and the underlying leases with all of our tenants say that when we renew or modify this lease, we will update the lease language. Now, not every tenant is willing to do that, but we do our very best to incorporate new language and update our language.
So one of the things we can do for the commission is Tamara's got a very good user group of finance folks from different ports that email each other regularly. She can survey them and find out what everyone else is at.
My next question, you can read my mind. That was my next question.
If everybody else is doing. If everyone else is at two or three, then we're probably a little high. But yeah, so we'll find that out for you and report back.
You know, my mom used to say, if everybody was jumping off the bridge, would you do that too?
We'll just do what everybody else is doing.
I wouldn't use my best line.
Mm-hmm. Although, sometimes what everybody else is doing is the right thing to do.
Sometimes.
Thanks, Sherwood. Mr. Robbins, anything?
I have nothing. No, most of my ones were answered earlier.
All right, great. Ms. Fuchs?
I'm good.
Nothing? Right? Tamara? Other staff? The one guy who stuck it out?
Gets an award, huh? We got some trail mix here for him.
You know, it's funny whenever I think about attendance here, and we're really small potatoes comparatively, but y'all remember when C-SPAN got started, and this is like a big deal. C-SPAN got started, and suddenly the entire nation noticed that there was one person standing at the podium talking to the president. The senator or something like that, and there was nobody in the room. So then somebody changed the rules, and now the camera just sits on one guy or woman because there's nobody in the room except for those two people. So there's nobody here today, but thanks to all who did come. Thank you, sir, and we are adjourned.